So a few of us were in a workshop with Linda last 2 days about fearless change. One of the big learnings was sitting is the new smoking. The more you sit, the more harm it is doing to your body. And she equated it to its as bad effect as when you're smoking, even secondhand smoke. So, let's practice that. Let's not make sitting a smoking exercise. And given that it is after lunch also, let's all stand up for a few minutes.
2 minutes?
No, we'll do some exercises. We have to make sure we wake up. And in the process, I'll also wake up before we start the session. Okay? Everyone had a good lunch? Very good lunch or good lunch?
Very good lunch.
Very good lunch means you just increase the exercise time that much more. Okay, too late. Too late. So what we want to do is just do a few energizers of sorts. The first thing what we want to do is just raise your hands on the side, down, turn around, except the last row, except the last row. And let's just introduce ourselves to the person who we have in front of us. just find someone. We just want to break the ice. And okay, that's it. Please take a seat. Thank you for bearing with me. I'm just trying to clear my voice and get started. And at the same time, hopefully that would have given you a few more minutes of wake-up time than the sleep time. Good afternoon, everyone. Oh, that was a real slow good afternoon. Anyway, this is not a class, this is not a lecture. Thank you for coming to this session. I know there were other interesting choices also. I'm going to talk about, the title at least says, to deploy or not to deploy, decide using test and analyzer. A very quick introduction about myself. I'm Anand Bagmar. I'm currently playing the role of a test practice lead at ThoughtWorks. Titles are interchangeable. I'm a hands-on tester. I do everything related with testing. And I've been doing so for more than 15 years. A very quick contact information if you want to connect with me later to have more follow-up discussions. You can get my Twitter ID or more contact information from the About Me page. And that's all I'm really going to talk about myself. What do you really expect from this session? Why are you here? Because if there is a mismatch, as Naresh said in the morning, it would be great to use the law of 2 feet. Okay? So, why are you here? Anyone? What do you expect from this session?
Learn about the PTA.
Learn about PTA?
Apply, if possible, to the current work.
Okay. It will not work in your case. Okay? Just a heads up. Don't be surprised if it is not going to work. And I'll tell you the reason why I would say.
Understand new perspective.
Understand new perspective. Yes, we'll be covering that in certain ways.
Understand your thoughts, if you have done any extensive research, to decide whether to go ahead with the check-in and deploy or to stop because there is a alarm.
Okay. We'll definitely be talking about that. That is really the crux of these next 40, 45 minutes that we'll be interacting with each other. Any other thoughts? Any other expectations?
You had mentioned about the COVID test analyzer or something.
Test and analyzer.
So I wanted to know, how did you go about selecting that tool and why that tool?
Okay. That answer is easy, I created it. But there is more to it, so don't go right now. But we'll be talking more on that, why not test and analyzer. Okay? So, no, why I said no, it's not going to work for you, and that's the risk of I see, especially when I go to conferences, when I've seen others go to conferences, we come for ready-made solutions in certain ways. And more often than not, we take a solution out of context and try to apply it in our situation. And it may not be the right fit. So the reason I'm saying it is not going to work is for you to really look at all the different parameters, to really investigate and see if it will help you. If yes, then this is the best tool you can ever have. Okay? But it's not about the tool, it's more about the thought process. So with that, what are the criteria for determining if your code is ready to get into the next stage of build cycle or deployment cycle?
It compiles.
First most important check, yes.
Passes all your tests,
okay.
Defect free
and passes all the tests. We are going to touch upon this topic after about 10-ish minutes. Hold on to that thought for sure. Okay, but yes?
Making sure that the dependencies are not cyclic and they won't cause issues.
Making sure dependencies are not cyclic and they don't cause issues, okay? So there are various different criteria, right? And depending on the nature of the application you're working on, the domain, there are many more parameters that need to be added and considered. And it's not, is it an easy process? Can we just take a half minute look at whatever report and say yes, I'm good to go or not? No? Okay. So, before we get into the next stage, let's get a pulse of all you guys in the room. How many of us are not in the software industry? Okay, everyone is from software field. That's good. How many of you are working on agile based methodology? Almost everyone? Okay, let me change the question. How many of you are not working on agile based methodology? Okay, there are a few. This is still going to be applicable for you also. Though I talk a lot in the agile context, it is still going to be applicable for other methodologies also. Okay. How many of us are managers of any different sorts, any different levels? How many of us are managers in this room? One? Okay. How many development managers or development managers mostly? Any testing manager? Yes, no? Okay. PMs? Project managers? Any business analysts? Any developers? Hands-on developers? Okay, good spread. Any testers? Excellent. We've got a really good mix over here. And please feel free to pitch in with your own perspective, because each role brings a different perspective in determining is the product ready or not. Right? And there are various reasons for it. Okay. What is the main objective of any organization?
Make money.
Okay? I would also equate it to provide value. And so just don't talk, but you've seen the slides in some ways. Okay? But very right. One of the main objectives is to make money or provide some value, give some service to your customer base. The other objectives are, I cannot make money or provide value if I'm delayed or I take too long to do that. Right? So it has to be in a timely fashion. I have to get my service or product out to the market in a good fashion. And is this the only thing?
Quality.
Most important, right? Or I shouldn't say most important, because none of these can exist independently for an organization. If any of these is missing, you cannot really deliver good software. So quickly, I'm going to rush through a couple of things about reality in organizations. We are a global organization. We are in a globalized software industry of sorts. And for various reasons, there's globalization, there's cost factors, we want 24/7 availability, there's talent in various different, all parts of the world, team sizes are too huge to really have under one roof. And there are also mergers and acquisitions which result in the teams really getting spread across the world. Okay? Given this ecosystem, given the value of the organization, each team, each product team, or each program of work needs to have some set of processes, guidelines, and adopt some patterns which is going to give or get them on the path of achieving their objectives, right? So, what is one of the practices that makes teams successful on this path? Collaboration? Communication? There are many other practices, right? What other practices do we use in our day-to-day activities?
Procedures.
Procedures. You mean more in terms of process or okay, process? You are right, and so far you are right, but there's probably at least 100 times more number of practices. And I can keep going till I get the right answer, or you give me some more answers and I'll give you the one I am looking.
Learning from mistakes.
Learning from mistakes? That's not really a practice though, is it? Or yeah, maybe it is. Okay?
Continuous improvement.
Continuous improvement, okay? That's more of a process, not a practice.
Retrospective.
Retrospective, discipline in what sense? So this is more on the technical side, right? What I'm looking for. And okay, that's fine, you guys are not going to get the answer I'm looking for. It is test automation. Okay? This is one of the practices, not the practice. It is one of the practices that you need to employ to get on the path of having good quality, get the product out in good time, to make money and or provide value. What is one of the practices that makes the team unsuccessful? Sorry?
Time consumption.
Time consumption in what way?
To deliver the product.
Sorry?
To deliver the product.
To deliver product, okay.
Bad quality.
Bad quality, okay. But that's not a practice, right? That's a measure of whatever practices we want to do.
Lack of quality control.
Lack of quality control. Okay.
Wrong estimation.
Wrong estimation. How many of us are part of successful projects we've never had any problems? So why are we not able to come up with more practices which have not worked for us?
Requirements not analyzed properly.
Requirements not analyzed properly. Now we are getting somewhere. Do we need to do another round of exercise? Yes?
Team is not self-sufficient.
Team is not self-sufficient or self-running in various ways. Okay. You guys are not going to get this answer also. It is also test automation. Okay, why? Because if test automation is not done right, it is going to be more of a crippling factor for the team than a enabler to get to the next stage. So it is very important to do test automation correctly. What is test automation? Anyone? So it's the safety net. Automation is a safety net. If something that was working right now, I've written a test around it, I want to know if that functionality breaks. It's a safety net, right? The net, how many of us know about fishing? Almost everyone, right? Fishermen use nets to catch fish. Would a fisherman use a fishing net of a very big grid size to catch a small fish? At the same time, if a fisherman wants to catch big fish, does it help him to have the net size very granular? He'll end up catching a lot of trivial things which he's not interested in. Automation is exactly like that. If you don't have effective automation, you might end up with so many tests which is not really providing any value. At the same time, if you have a lot of gaps in your automation, issues are still going to creep through. And you will see issues or defects later on in your product life cycle, which is going to be very costly to fix. Okay? How many of us have heard about the test automation pyramid? Okay? A few of us. So very quickly I'll explain what the test automation pyramid is. It is a pyramid. Behind the pyramid, there is a big circle. What the pyramid represents is various different types of tests which are applicable for your product under test. Okay? And it could start right from unit tests, integration, JavaScript, view tests, web service tests, UI tests, and various other types that are or not listed over here, right? The circle on the top represents a very focused manual or exploratory testing that is required, that is essential on the product. Now, why? Because not everything should be automated again, right? You don't want to automate things which are going to take a lot of time or cost to do that and plan reliably. Why is this pyramid important? Because as you start going from bottom of the pyramid to the top, what happens is the cost of implementing each test increases, the cost of getting feedback from each test increases, and of course, the time that it takes. Right? Why? Because at the unit test level on a dev machine, I can run the test against the code by just compiling and running tests against it. I don't have to deploy it in any environment or any container or integrate it with anything else. But as I move up that pyramid, I need to get more and more pieces of my product together in order to enable those types of tests. So what this means is, we need to have a test very effective. The test which are at the lowest level of the pyramid should touch the granularest piece of the code. The triangle, the inverted pyramid, represents the product and the test. Impact of each test on the product. Unit test touches the granular piece of code. As you move up, the UI test touches the breadth of the product where all integration points are set up, for example, all systems are set up, databases are hooked up, external interfaces are set up correctly. It takes a long time to get all this done. So the least number of tests should have the impact on the widest of the product, not the breadth, the granular pieces. What this also means is, till we get to the view test, these are more technology facing tests. I need to change the radio button to a checkbox. That's a granular test. I don't need to have a full-fledged UI test framework for that. At the same time, the top-level tests, the web services, UI, or the manual exploratory tests, they are more business-facing tests. What value am I really solving? What feature am I really validating for the product? Okay? So that is what the test pyramid is. But if you look at reality, and this is where I want you to introspect on the products that you are working on, I see there are two types of anti-patterns at least that most organizations end up with, most teams end up with. One is called the ice cream cone anti-pattern, where what we have is, we've got the least number of unit tests, maximum number of UI tests, and what happens when you have so many UI tests? Do they run reliably every time? Do they give consistent results every time? How much time does it take for running and getting feedback from these? As a result, what happens? In spite of spending all this effort on UI automation, we have to put a big effort on manual and exploratory testing runs. This is a classic anti-pattern which a lot of organizations end up with. It might be a good place to get started with, but if you don't have the right focus on the teams, you'll end up over here. The second is a dual test pyramid anti-pattern. Can anyone guess what these two are? One is a developer's test pyramid. Second is the QA team test pyramid. And there is a big divide between them. It's a silo, not really a divide. The QA team is working on the other side of this wall, and the development team is over here. As a result, what happens is there might be a lot of scenarios, test cases, that get missed out in automation because of lack of collaboration. There might be a lot of duplication also that happens between these two pyramids because of lack of collaboration. As a manager, I know Hitesh is a QA manager right now. Can you live with duplicated tests or can you live with missed tests?
You can't live with missed tests.
Can't live with missed tests. It's an obvious answer. That is the biggest risk to any organization, any team, to miss any critical scenarios. You're not going to be ever test complete per se, right? But you don't want to miss out any critical scenarios. So this is an anti-pattern that we definitely want to try and avoid. So in each of your teams, what does your test pyramid look like? Is that the right pyramid to be in? It's something for you to determine, okay? Pyramid is a philosophical thing. It represents equal sides, right? All three sides are equal. But it never says how much should be the ratio between UI and unit test, for example, or UI and web service test, for example. Only the team can determine what is the correct split. Eventually, it's all about how quickly can I get my feedback, how all my tests are complementing each other to give a sense of quality. Okay? Given that we know all this now, we all know how continuous integration works. Good assumption, bad assumption? Okay, we need to get some coffee for everyone. Everyone seems to be dozing off. Does everyone know continuous integration?
Yes.
Okay. Anyone not work on continuous integration before? Everyone has. So I'm going to skip certain slides to get to meatier content. Okay. Simple thing, any developer does a check-in, we want to run a suite of tests automatically on every check-in as often as possible to ensure nothing is broken. Okay. And there will be various different types of tests that we want to run in a particular sequence for that matter to get that earliest feedback. Now, what happens when you run these tests? What would teams do with it? They look at the dashboard, whichever the CI tool might be. You go and look at the dashboard, you might have a various different set of tests configured over there. But from the dashboard, you will actually try and make sense. What is the sale or quality of your product? I have 10,000 unit tests, out of which 1% failed. Is that good or bad? Right? After unit tests, I have got my web service tests, and they all passed fine. My function tests all passed fine. In most cases, that is sufficient. As long as my build is green, all my tests are passing, it is fine. Right? It works well for smaller teams. And again, it's a relative term in that sense. But if you have a certain number of jobs in Jenkins, for example, you'll still be able to aggregate the results out of them and make meaningful dashboards out of them. How many of us really work in small teams? Okay. What's the size of a team?
Six.
Five.
Is that a product team or is that your team size?
Product team is 9
QAs or the 9 people over?
4 developers.
Okay. Ideal situation, you can leave right. Okay. The point I'm trying to make is, for small teams, these dashboards are sufficient to give a sense of quality, give a sense of trend, what is happening in your product, and to see if everything is going fine or not. There are still certain limitations though that we'll see. However, what happens in really complex teams, in enterprise products? Think about the globalized picture that we saw earlier, right? Typically, teams are 300, 400 people spread across the globe, various different time zones, working on different functionalities. And this is not even talking about the external dependencies in the organization for sorts, right? In such a large team, and Shirish has been part of one of such teams, so it was just about 50-ish people from here. At one point in time, his team had about 50 jobs in the Go server that were configured. Now, whatever form of aggregation you do for these 50 jobs, you are not going to get a proper representation of what the quality really means. There's a lot of effort that needs to be put in over there. Okay? And if the teams are really large in that sense, you have to start creating functional teams of sort, or break it down into various different levels. And that's where what typically tends to happen is, oh, product one and product two, you're sort of related. We'll share one Jenkins server or one CI server. Product three and four, let's have another server set up for you. And you can set up your jobs and manage your continuous integration more effectively. But what happens is all these products, they're really one enterprise. They're not related. They all need to go live at some similar structured timeline. So someone, a CEO, a CTO, whoever that person might be, would suddenly come and say, hey guys, tell me what's the status. Are we good for the release of this core banking platform in 3 years' time? How are you going to do that? We've got different information in different servers. That information might mean different things at each time. So what happens? Different team members, managers, or whoever start doing this work manually and create this kind of consolidated report for someone to share and say, yes, we are on track or not. And when we put caffeine on continuous integration, we get to continuous delivery. Where on every check-in, potentially, if the build has passed, everything has passed, I should be ready to go live. I should be ready to take it to the next level, continuous delivery. With that, imagine the effort is going to take to really collaborate and get these reports together on a continuous fashion for someone who very clearly needs to get them. There's a good reason to get that. How do you do that? How can you avoid doing this manual effort? That is one. How can we be accurate in terms of your data? That is the other aspect. Okay? So how do you really know your product is ready to go live or ready to go to the next level? It's not really an easy thing unless you're in a small team where you can manage that much more effectively. Also, this is the part where I was asking earlier. Does a green pill really means there are no defects? How do you know? How do you try and manage that? These were the problems which I encountered on one of the projects I was working on about 3 years ago. And I had this idea to say, no, I need a better way, a more data-driven approach to enable making better decisions. Clearly, I cannot or don't even want to spend time in building a product or a solution which is automatically going to give me the answer. It's not possible. It's like the pyramid. There is no right answer unless you put in a lot of context to it. So how can I get data in a uniform fashion for an enterprise solution to enable the relevant stakeholders take better decisions? To enable teams take better decisions, am I ready to go to the next level or not? And that is how TTA was test trend analyzed. Though it says trend analyzer, there is definitely much more to this than just trend analysis. And we'll see that more in form of a demo. So there are a couple of aspects to this demo that I'm going to talk about. One is, what is the trend analysis capability of this? Failure analysis, which is also equally important, and I'll tell you why in the demo itself. Dashboards. We don't want to replicate information which is available in various other systems that our enterprise is using just because we want to move to a unified tool. Each tool is doing things in its own best way possible. We already have it in the enterprise. We don't want to duplicate anything. We don't want to replace anything. At the same time, we want to provide a consistent, holistic view of the product and its quality in one place. So we'll talk about dashboards. Some admin and how to upload data, we'll look at that also. Okay? So with that, we'll switch to a demo. So I have TTA running on my machine right now. There is a reason why I'm not going to zoom in. Suresh was one of the developers who helped build the UI for this, and then he ran off on another project. So I've left it in the same state, and I was waiting for this moment to tell him where you've left me. I need your information. Okay? So it's not really about the content over here. I think the concept is more important, what we are trying to solve with this. The reason I'm going to zoom in, but please be aware that this project was really built as a beach project of sorts, as a side pet project of sorts, built by QAs, developers, whoever it might be right out of college, with a little help from others. So it's again not about implementation, look and feel, it's more about the concept. So the first thing what we are going to look at over here is trend analysis. That by all means is very important, especially in enterprise products, where I want to look at the product development lifecycle itself might be a couple of years, if not more. But there are also different versions over a period of time, and the product suite is around for decades for a good reason. Core banking is a classic example in that, right? So in that case, I don't want to know what is my current state of the product. I want to know how it compares with the earlier state also. I want to know if I'm making progress or not. It is very important to understand behind the square box is the different types of tests that have been automated for sub-project 1.1. It's functional, integration, and unit tests in that sequence. What it says is there are 350 functional tests, 98 integration, and 99 unit tests, and the time it takes to run these. So at a single click, using the latest data available with TTA for this sub-project, I know what my pyramid looks like. Now this becomes very valuable for me to say from a practice perspective, this definitely is not right. I know my product better. I need to be doing more at unit test level, I need to invest more on unit testing side, and I need to reduce my functional testing, not just to reduce the numbers, but have more effective tests over it. Less number, but more effective tests. So this can become a conversation point for various team members to say, this is where we are. How are we, how do we want to be in the next 3 months? And you can sort of use this as a reference to start planning now. So this data becomes very powerful. With additional functionality implemented on this, I can say, okay, show me two pyramid views for the same project, one from 3 months ago and one today, where, how do I compare? I don't want to create two different views for this, but I want to do a side-by-side comparison. You can do various things once the data is available. Okay? That's one. A very quick second example. In this case, it's more balanced. I just have functional integration. But it might be right for my product. This is not telling you what is right or wrong. It's just telling you what your product is doing at this point in time. Okay? So that is the pyramid view. Next, let's look at a comparative analysis. I know there is a lot of effort in my organization where we are putting emphasis on automation of various different types. What value is it really bringing to the team? How is the quality of the product across all these different types of tests really happening? I don't want to go to CI and say, okay, this is aggregation of my unit test. This is aggregation of my functional test. This is aggregation of my sanity test. So whatever those job aggregation groups are. Because you cannot aggregate unit tests and functional tests. It's not going to provide any value in Jenkins or any CI tool, right? So how do you really figure out what is happening? So in the comparative analysis view, I select a time range, a particular project and sub-project, and then I select which type of test am I really looking at, am I interested in for this. In this case, I'm going to have all these tests selected, all types of tests which I have data for. I just wanted to plot a graph for this. So what this graph tells me is, for the time range, each of these tests, and there's a legend which sort of tries to map a color with what type of test it is. It will tell me, each circle representing a test run, what was the status of that test in that time period. So now I can look at it and say, most of my tests are at this level. There are times when it suddenly dips. Why is that happening? Without seeing this holistic view again, in a large enterprise, it becomes difficult to find out where to start focusing on finding the root cause. I don't want to get lost in that big ecosystem of tests and thousands of tests and so many different teams. I need to know a starting point. This becomes very powerful from that perspective. It is showing a trend, and it can show a trend for as much data as we really have. Let's look at another example. I say project one, which has got various different sub-projects as part of it, but I'm interested in comparing only the unit tests across all these different projects, and I want to see what is happening. So each of unit test coverage and the pass percentage, this left side is the pass percentage over here. I want to know how is my unit testing happening across all these projects? Because there might be so many types of tests, you want to filter it down, right? You want to narrow down the scope of your need. Likewise, you could do it for functional tests, sanity tests, regression tests, whichever way you have tagged it. So again, at a click of a button, giving the right parameters, you can look at data over a period of time across the enterprise, different products, projects, sub-projects, whatever your classification might be, and try and make some sense out of it, and figure out, is there something that needs help? Is there some team which is doing really well who can help out other teams to do better? It becomes data-based approach instead of gut feel-based approach. Okay? And anyone can see this. The next thing which I have found to be very, very valuable is test execution trends. How many of us do performance testing on our projects? Automated performance testing. Okay, not automated. Okay, we do performance testing, a couple of us. When do we typically do performance testing? When there's a problem, that's a valid scenario.
Before
taking
the
iteration.
Some during the iteration and some before the release.
Some during iteration, some before the release. Okay. Any other patterns?
Before we done. We have it as a criteria that the story cannot be said that it's done until the performance criteria is met. So we do some.
Okay. Ideal situation, almost ideal situation, right? Where you've got performance or NFR benchmarks or requirements as part of the story development itself. That's the ideal state. However, it's very difficult to really get it down to that level in most cases again. So I hope you continue going on that path for sure. Okay? What I found of value is we run so many tests anyway in dev environment, QA environments, whatever the environment might be, whether it's functional or unit or any type of test. Each test has execution time. Now, if I have written a login test, for example, from a UI perspective, a successful login test, an unsuccessful login test where I'm validating the error message over there, that's a valid test. If I can capture this number of test execution time, and it will include a lot of other things also, right? Open the browser and wait for the browser to be loaded or login page to be loaded before anything else happens. So it does have a lot of noise around the actual metric, but if you start capturing this metric on a consistent basis, you can figure out if my login test was taking 10 seconds after opening the browser, loading the login page, can I capture this as a trend to see is my login test taking more than 10 seconds at any point in time? Does anyone see value in that? It's what I call it a functional performance test really, not a true application performance test. It's not a separate environment or anything. There are a lot of factors where things might go wrong. And just using that on the project where I was working, where there was no special performance testing done at all, but it was an auction site that we were working on. There had to be some form of performance testing done. I started capturing this metric in form of automation code, just put it in the CSV and look at it. But this becomes even easier because tests are running anyway. So what I'm doing is, again, I select what exactly am I looking for. The time period when I'm looking for. And based on this, it will tell me which tests have executed in this time period. I select any one test and I say plot. What this does for me is, in that time period, it will tell me for this test, it kept on going from about 14 seconds, 20 seconds, 3 seconds, it went all the way over here to about 37 seconds, and there's a spike. Now we know because it's not a dedicated performance environment, the all the results on the top and especially on the top, you can sort of ignore or put less priority. Maybe there's a network delay or something in certain cases. You know for sure the ones that ended very quickly, especially this one, something really went wrong. Maybe the page itself did not load for that matter. There was error. So again, you can ignore that. But then, if looking at this graph, I say this seems to be the general time period between 14 and 22 seconds, if that is a general time period, anything out of this range is an anomaly. And now, I can, with data points, focus on which test execution cycle shall I focus on to identify if something really changed. If this, for example, this one, 28 seconds, that is out of the range, why did it suddenly go here? It then went down again, but what if it is not going down? I can investigate what changes happened in the product at that point in time, which potentially caused an increase in test execution, or there might be other reasons. But now again, I have got direction where to focus on root cause analysis. I'm not shooting in the dark. Okay? So this is what the trend analysis does. Any questions, thoughts so far? We'll get to that point. Now, hold on. So the question was, can it compare between browsers? It has the ability to do much more than what you just said, but we'll get to that part in a little. Okay? So this is on the, yeah?
Just curious, it seems there's a fair amount of overlap with this tool and something like Sonar. So I'd be curious as to why some of the gaps that may be found in Sonar and why you would choose to spin up a different tool.
Yeah, so Sonar, correct me if I'm wrong, I've not worked directly on Sonar myself, but it captures metrics from directly from the code itself, right? Would that
be
right?
It's got a plugin ecosystem, but primarily your CI can feed Sonar, aggregate projects,
mm-hmm.
Your test results are reported, your unit tests,
yeah.
And
There will be in a certain cases. So the advantage of this one is I could be running tests on my dev machine itself, and I can still report it to TDA to capture that also. That is one advantage. I don't think from a functional testing perspective, Sonar might, actually I don't really know about Sonar as much to comment much on it. But I do know there are certain features that Sonar doesn't have, which when we get to the failure analysis, become really valuable for teams to look at. So maybe we should talk after this session so I can understand more about Sonar.
Does the statistic mean that on different dates, no, let's say it's a project lifecycle, and we are checking in test cases day after day,
mm-hmm.
and then you're running the test suit, and then this information gets collected. So let's say on a particular date, it's just shot up. So probably that's a point to look at or analyze that why it shot up on that day, and then
exactly. And this is exactly what it is doing. Right? It is just giving you data points in a visual form, so that you can investigate at the correct place instead of trying to find out where to look at, which bits to look at, which commits to look at, for example. Okay? So let's look at failure analysis. I think a lot of value can come out in failure analysis also. So one thing is compare runs. Hitesh, what you're asking, right? Compare between browsers. The current functionality doesn't support it. All we support right now is if I select a project, sub-project, I select which type of test I want. Let's say it's an integration test. I automatically get the set of dates for which I have test runs over here, and I can compare it. Okay? Over here, actually I'll jump a little bit ahead. Close your eyes and just listen to what I'm saying for 10 seconds. In your CI, for example, aggregated report or not, if you see 95% pass tests consistently. Last one was 95%, day before yesterday it was 95%, today it was 95%. Does it mean the same 5% tests are failing at all times?
Not necessarily.
Not necessarily. How would you know? Compare it. What if you have thousands of tests? So you see the problem I'm trying to say, right? This is not even open. This is what compare runs does. Select two bits of similar types. In this case, they are similar because same sub-project, same type of test. I'm just selecting different runs. And I'm saying compare these and tell me what has happened. In this case, I see the number of unique tests failing on both days. So tests which are common failures across both, I want to identify that. I want to identify the tests which have failed, unique tests which have failed in both these test runs. So I might have A, B failing yesterday, and I have B, C failing today. So this list will be A, B, C for that matter. These are all the tests that have failed. And that combination, tests which have failed on both days, tests which have passed consistently, tests which failed yesterday, but not today. And the fourth is tests which failed today, not yesterday. With this, I know exactly where I need to focus. If a test, what is going to be most valuable for me? Test which was passing yesterday is failing today. That's a regression. I need to capture that as quickly as possible. That's where I need to focus on it. Okay? With the kind of metadata that we capture with the uploaded test, we can extend the functionality to say, this type of test running against IE versus Firefox, compare. Running against RC1 versus RC2, compare. The metadata is there. You just need to write the appropriate query and display it in a little more visual format, where you can start focusing on what is happening. So it can be extended to support different browsers or different OS, whatever combinations, or build numbers, as long as you're capturing that information with extensions or extensions in the code to support that in TDA, you should be able to query it. Okay? Another important thing, 5% test failing. If I've got 10,000 unit tests, 5% of those tests are failing. Are we sure they're failing for different reasons? They could be, could not be. A lot of those 5% might be for the same reason for that matter. Something changed in the mock I'm using, that's why all related tests are failing. So, in failure analysis, again going through the same pattern, I select a specific run. do the failure analysis for you. So this assumes makes a big assumption that whatever error logging you are doing in your automation, whichever form of automation, has to be consistent. It has to be rich in its messages that it fails for. What TTA does is, for a specific execution cycle, look at it, analyze it, and group tests which are failing for the same reason. Based on that, I have got a lot of failures in this particular test run, but 33% of my tests are failing with the message, error message for class 1.1, and these are the tests which are failing because of that. There is 3% tests which are failing with error message for class 21.3. These are the tests for that. Which test will I try and fix first?
Maximum.
So again, it's an 80-20 rule, right? You're trying to identify the low-hanging fruit, which is going to get you towards a green build as quickly as possible. That is what failure analysis helps you. Classification or other grouping based on error messages to help you focus on the right thing. Okay? Last thing I want to show you over here before we run out of time is, we spoke about different dashboards. Sonar has got excellent reports. If you're using Jira for requirements tracking, that can, you can get excellent reports out of that for defects and whatever else. You don't want to duplicate any of that just because you want your tool to be popular. And it's never going to be possible getting all types of information in one system. So what provision I've done here, instead of having to do a lot of context switch, I can just give the link to that particular dashboard, give it a meaningful name. So in this case, I'm going to give TTA. I'm going to say, HTTP localhost 3000 add. And what I see over here when I go to the home page, I've got my external dashboards configured and just pulling in reports from whatever other reports might already be configured. So I don't have to go to some other place. I'm not duplicating data. At the same time, I don't want to do the context switching too many times. One bookmark can get me everything. Okay? So that's it for the demo side of things. Very quickly, I'm going to jump to, because we are almost out of time, I'm going to jump to how does this really work and the value it brings to the teams. Okay? So typically when we run tests from CI, they run on agents or machines that are configured with that CI. And what that does is, when the command comes into the machine, you do a clean, compile, setup, run the test, and send the results back to CI. The difference now becomes is, after you run the test, you're changing it, making a slight change to say, send results to TTA first, and then return to CI. So CI still has the information it had earlier, and only difference is you have sent the results over there also. Why is this very popular or very powerful? My CI could be anything. It can be Go, Watson, Jenkins, Bamboo, TeamCD, anything. My build tool can be anything. Maven, Gradle, Ant, Make, Rake, whatever it might be, MS test, anything. My test can be implemented in any language. It does not matter. It's any XUnit or TestNG based reports, does not matter. And any programming language for that matter. All that you need to do is look at the build tool and write that small snippet to send the results to TTA at the relevant time. That's the only difference. Everyone else is unaffected by this. Okay? So this becomes very powerful. There are many, I will be uploading these slides today itself to my blog, and the video also will be available. After this session, we can talk more about how you can really use TTA and see if it will work for you, for example, right? Most important thing is you set it up. There is a manual upload page where you provide all the details required for uploading test results and see if that upload is successful. What that means is the result types the XUnit test reports that is required for TTA to consume. We'll be able to see if there's parity, there's a match in that. As long as the reports can be parsed, TTA is going to work for you. If it cannot be parsed, then we need to build an extension in TTA to support the report types that your test framework is generating, and then it can be used. There are, at the same time, a lot of hard-coded things in terms of types of tests, for example, functional, integration, unit tests. You might be using different terminology in your organization, in your teams. We'll need to figure out ways to customize that directly in code or make it extensible in TTA. Remember, this is a very nascent product built as a side project, right? It has a lot of capabilities to improve, And there are a bunch of features which I already have in mind, but it's not the full reach, rich feature set right now. But try it out, it might work well. Okay? How can you help? Try it out, give feedback, suggest features. More importantly, this is available on GitHub, it's an open source project. ThoughtWorks has allowed me, given me time and help in building this, and we made this open source. You can contribute to it. Send me pull requests, and we can work collaboratively in whichever fashion to add more features and make this better and more usable. Okay? With that, I would like to say thank you and not go even more beyond what I was supposed to. Any questions you can?